Okay, so here we go. If you're joining us at home, watching, you're here in the room, today we're going to do what we do all the time here. We're going to open up God's Word and we're going to see what God's Word says to us. Y'all good with that?
Yes.
That's what we're going to do. And so we are people who say that we love the book and we want to hear what the book says. And so that's what we do today. So I pray that you hear God's Word clearly and you let Him apply it to your life appropriately. What we're going to talk about today is very good and powerful truth. But it's truth that sometimes is hard to live out in our lives. So the message that we hear today, the truth that we hear today, may be a hard word for some to hear. May be easy for others to hear. I'm admitting this morning that the truths that I find in this text have always not lived out perfectly by me, and I'm sure they're not lived out perfectly by you. But the point is, we can't perfectly live out God's truth, but it doesn't mean that it's not true. Amen? It's true. And so we humbly come to God's Word today, and we see it applied to our lives. Last week, we saw from God's Word as these Jewish Christians that are being written to here through the book of Hebrews, that they needed to continue on in their race of faith. They had to persevere. That's been this ongoing theme that we've been considering. And last week, we looked at the Old Covenant and how much better the New Covenant was and the joy that the New Covenant brought. We talked about the unshakable kingdom that's coming one day, and we said that our response to that should be grateful worship to the Lord because of Him bringing an unshakable kingdom that we will all be a part of one day. Aren't you thankful for that?
Yes.
We're to be thankful to God. So we've been considering like our vertical relationship with the Lord and what that should look like and the heart of grateful worship to Him. Today we kind of turn the corner in chapter 13 and we find very practical truth that we're to live out in the horizontal relationships that we have with others. And it's very important for us to do that. It's very important for us to live in enduring love in our lives, because if we don't live demonstrating love in our lives, we are going to have a hard time completing our race of faith. Love is intricately necessary for us running the race of faith. And so we're going to look at that today. You have 4 points today, and I can promise you we're only going to get to 3, okay? Because we only got to 3 in first service, and I got more time in first service than I do in second service. So we're going to get to the 3 today, so listen quick. Let's see what God's Word has to say to us. Hebrews chapter 13, starting in verse 1 and following, it says these words, "Let brotherly love continue. Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. Remember those who are in prison, as those in prison with them, and those who are mistreated, since you also are in the body. Let marriage be held in honor among all, and let the marriage bed be undefiled. For God will judge the sexually immoral and adulterous. Keep your life free from the love of money, and be content with what you have. For He who has said, 'I will never leave you nor forsake you,' so we can confidently say, 'The Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me?'" So today we consider these points. The first point I want us to consider is that we, as we run our race of faith as believers, we need to make sure that we have love for one another. We must have love for one another. Look what it says in verse 1. Let brotherly love continue. Now, when times get tough, we can either find ourselves being drawn closer together in our trials, or we can find that when times get tough, we find that we're driven away from one another and we're not loving each other as we should. These Jewish Christians had started with close affection for one another, but over the course of time, running their race of faith, experiencing the hardships and the dangers that they were experiencing, their love was in danger of growing cold for one another. And it says here, let brotherly love continue. Now, last week we considered the difference between the inadequacy of the Old Covenant and the joy of the New Covenant. And under the New Covenant, we find that Jews and Gentiles alike are God's people. That's what we find under the New Covenant. Jews and Gentiles. Under the Old Covenant, it was all about the Jewish people. But under the New Covenant, Jews and Gentiles alike are brought into the family of God. And all God's people said, amen. Now, there's a lot more to it than just that. This is very important. All those, listen to me, all those who place their faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior are all brought into the same family. The same family. Anyone who trusts their Savior, anyone who trusts Christ as their Savior for the forgiveness of their sin, they are my brothers and sisters in Christ. We are family, and we should love as family loves. Let brotherly love continue. And I'm not talking about dysfunctional family. I'm talking about a healthy family where love is given freely. When love is demonstrated one to another, that let that brotherly love continue among you. Listen to what Paul states, and this is very relevant to our culture that we live in today. Galatians chapter 3, verses 25 through 29. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under a guardian. For in Christ Jesus, listen to this, you are all sons of God through faith. For as many as you were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female. For you are all, what? One in Christ. One in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. There was real animosity and hatred between Jews and Gentiles in this day. But as Jews and Gentiles trusted Christ for their salvation and the forgiveness of their sin, they were now in this same family. They were not, listen to this, they were not primarily recognized by their ethnicity, but they were recognized by their identity in Christ. Do you hear me? This has everything to do with the world in which we live in today. Believers in Jesus Christ are not segmented out by their ethnicity. We are brought together in unity by our identity in Christ. Very important. But sadly, we live in a world that wants to segment us by our ethnicity. And there are even Christians who hold to this understanding as well. And there are even pastors and leaders that I respect that are holding to an understanding of how who the body of Christ is in a different way than I understand it. Because I understand that we are all brought together through the shed blood of Jesus Christ based in our identity with Jesus. And it's in that that's the commonality that makes us brothers and sisters in Christ. We must remember that we're all created in the image of God. Every human that's born is created and is special and unique as they are created in the image of God. Very important for us to remember that. We are all of the same race of people. There are not races of people. There is the race, the human race. We're all created in the image of God. There are ethnicities, I understand that. But when we come to faith in Christ, that is not the primary. Our primary is our identity in Jesus Christ. Said it again. You know, anytime you see something in Scripture said multiple times, you know it's for emphasis purposes, right? When you hear a pastor do it, he's trying to say, that's pretty important, I think. It's important because we live in a world that believes otherwise. If we choose to segment ourselves away from one another and mainly identify in ethnic divisions, we will not foster love for one another. Instead, it fosters division and disunity and animosity. It does not foster love. And there is a pressure brought to bear on followers of Jesus Christ, especially on social media, to buy the other understanding of what it means how we get along. Listen to how Bodhi Bakum, who happens to be an African-American theologian and pastor, helps understand this pressure. He says, what worries me is that Christians in the age of social media care more what popular preachers have to say on issues like this and whether or not they agree with other popular preachers than they are about taking advantage of an opportunity to work through the challenges in the context of Christian community. More importantly, it worries me that so many Christians view themselves primarily as this or that ethnic community more than they see themselves as a member of the body of Christ. We must come together and celebrate the unifying bond of the gospel in our lives. You see, it's not just that we all come from the human race. It also, we all have the same problem no matter where we're at, no matter where we come from, no matter what the skin color of our skin is. We all have the same problem. It's a sin problem. And the same thing that cures the sin problem in my life as a white man is the same thing that will cure the sin problem in the life of any other person of any other color. It's all the same. We all find our forgiveness and our hope in Jesus Christ through the gospel of Jesus Christ and in nothing else. The world needs to hear that. So I believe that Christians need to refuse to be pitted against other brothers and sisters in Christ because of ethnicity. We come together and we unite ourselves around the gospel of Jesus Christ. And let me just be very clear. If you're a racist or know a racist or someone has racist thoughts or intents, that is sinful and it comes from the pit of hell. Can we get an amen on that? We're all created in the image of God. We all now, though, as believers in Christ, find our identity in Christ and we stand against racism, but the cure for racism is not going to be found in heightening ethnicities. The cure for racism is going to be the spread of the gospel of Jesus Christ and have the racist reform from his sin, turn from his sin, and trust in Christ alone. It's not found in anything else. The world needs to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ so we can let brotherly love continue. We commit to one another as family. When it says brotherly love continue, listen, when I call you a brother or sister in Christ, that should mean something. Those just aren't words we throw around. It's like, hey, brother, how you doing? It's not that. It means something. It means that when I see you, you are my brothers and sisters in Christ. We are a part of the same local community, body of believers right here, and we should see ourselves as family members with one another. And that means that we commit ourselves to one another. That means that I am not going to walk away from you just because something doesn't go exactly how I think it should go. I'm going to stay with you, and I commit myself to you because you are my family. Well, I don't know, preacher. I don't kind of like to get my way, and if it's not my way, then I'll just have to leave. Okay, well, that's fine. I understand that, but you're not committing yourself to family. We've got to commit to one another and love one another through the ups and downs, through the hard times and the good times. We let brotherly love continue amongst us. It's really important. Now, do we learn from people's life experiences? Do we learn from the backgrounds of people? Of course we do. Can I learn something from other brothers and sisters in Christ who had a different experience than me? Of course I can, and I should. But their experiences or my experiences do not trump the truthfulness of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So we celebrate the unifying force of the gospel of Jesus. That's what we do. We love one another. In the gospel of Jesus Christ. We love one another as family. We treat all people the way they should be treated. We see everyone as created in the image of God, but we let brotherly love continue among us, united around the gospel. Second, and by the way, let me just say, I'm normally not the kind of pastor that's going to come out of a sermon series just to speak into something happening in culture. Sometimes I will. But I've had people say, well, you've not spoken about any of these things as it relates to what's going on and all the marches and all the other stuff. Well, I just did. But I'm going to speak to them as I come to it in God's Word. And I'm not going to use this pulpit for some political agenda one way or another way. But we let the Word of God inform us on how we live in this world. At least that's the way I understand it to be. So there. There's my cards on that. Point number two, we also must see the need, if we're going to continue to run the race of faith, to love one another, brotherly love continue, but we're also going to have love for others, not just the family of God, but we will love the family of God, but we love those outside the family of God as well, right? It only makes sense for us who've been transformed by the love of Jesus Christ to be marked by love in the church and outside the church. Look what God's word says, verses 2 and 3. It says, do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for thereby some may have entertained angels unaware. Remember those who are in prison, as though in prison with them, and those who are mistreated, since you are also in the body. Now, I want to understand, in this point, we see both and. We love those in the body and outside the body, but right now we're going to talk about the importance of hospitality. Hospitality. Do not neglect to show hospitality. It says to strangers, and yes, that's true of strangers, but it also is speaking, I think, in this immediate context to these Jewish Christians, is show hospitality to your other brothers and sisters who've gotten locked up. Don't forget them. It was easy to walk away from people once they got locked up. Like, man, George was really good, but man, he got himself locked up. I'm not hanging out with George. I'm not worrying about George anymore. This is a call to have hospitality to strangers, but in the immediate context, it's also talking about have hospitality for other brothers and sisters of Christ who are struggling. Hospitality is really important, and we know it's important because of this phrase, some have entertained angels unaware. Now, that gets people's attention. What's that there for? This is most likely a reference to the hospitality given by Abraham in the Old Testament to three strangers who were unbeknownst to him, were angels. Genesis 18. These Jewish Christians would have remembered this occurrence and other occurrences in the Old Testament as well. But I like what R. Kent Hughes said in his commentary. He says, by reminding the people of the possibility of hosting a real angel, the writer of Hebrews was not promoting hospitality on the chance that one might luck out to get an angel. It wasn't like, hey, I want to be hospitable because I never know I might be hospitable to an angel. He says, but was simply saying that the possibility of its happening indicated how much God prioritizes hospitality in his people. Hospitality is a big deal. It's not just, you know, you think about hospitality, you start thinking about maybe a hotel you're going to stay in or somewhere where they're hospitable to me. That's not what we're talking about. I'm talking about us being vehicles of hospitality to other people. And it's very important. What's the definition of hospitality? I looked it up, at least one definition that I found. It says, the friendly and generous reception and entertainment of guests, visitors, and strangers. Now, times were tough when Hebrews was written. Traveling was hard and dangerous, and there was a great need for hospitality. There were few inns, and the inns that were there to stay in were filthy and dangerous. But also, Christians, these Jewish Christians who'd walked away from Judaism, would have not been welcomed by many people. And it was very important for Christians to be hospitable to other Christians and to take Christians in and to show them hospitality. It would have been very important for them to live this way. Hospitality is considered a Christian virtue. We're to take concrete steps that show with our lives to our brothers and sisters in Christ and to those outside of the body of Christ that we are hospitable people. Now, this is hard because we live in a day now where we all segment ourselves away. I get it. We're raised in a culture where hospitality is not what it used to be, right? My mom and dad, they loved hospitality. They loved it. We didn't have two pennies to rub together. We would eat the same stuff a lot, but she made it really good. And she was constantly looking to invite people to come over to our house, and she was hospitable, either to a neighbor or to people from church or something. And we practiced hospitality. I mean, I came home one day, there was a 19-year-old Jewish man who'd now taken residence up in my house. I'm like, who's this guy? Well, he prayed to receive faith in Christ and his family disowned him, so he's going to live with us. I'm like, okay. Weird to me. And he lived with us for like a year and a half. What were my mom and dad doing? They were practicing hospitality. And there's great power in hospitality. In the body of Christ, there are people that if we would, in our brothers and sisters in Christ right now, if we would be more hospitable, it would help so many people, it would encourage them so much. Just right here in this body. There are people outside of our church family that they don't understand hospitality. Listen, I'll just prove it to you. If you want to blow somebody's mind, go home and make a plate of cookies. cover it, go to their house, knock on the door, and say, hey, neighbor. Hopefully you've talked to them before. It would be really weird, right? You know, hey, man, hey, John, whatever, hey, Susie, whatever. I wanted to bring you these cookies. They're like, something wrong? No, man, I just wanted to do something. I just want to be hospitable to you. Okay. It's weird nowadays, right? Christians, look, ask yourself, oh, man. I know this is a point. You can run past this, and it's just like, oh, well, okay. No, this is important. There are single people in our church right now that they don't have anybody in this city, and they're lonely. And how powerful would it be to reach out to them and say, hey, why don't you come over and eat with us? Why don't you come over for Christmas? I know you can't travel. You can't get home. Come be with us. What about the widow or the widower who eats every meal by themselves at home? Maybe we reach out to someone like that and say, you know what? Once a week, I want you to come to my house because I want you to eat with us. And listen, you go buy McDonald's. I don't care. You don't have to cook. Just have them come over to be with you. Practice hospitality. It's really important to the body of Christ. And it's important to all those outside the body of Christ as well who have nobody. Ask yourself a couple questions. Do you see your home as your personal sanctuary or as a blessing from God that you are willing to share with others? Think about that. Do you see your home as your personal sanctuary or as a blessing from God that you're willing to share with others? Think about that. Now listen, if you're anything like me after a long day, what do you want to do? Man, I get home, shut the door, lock it, go get my bedpans on, and go relax. I'm just there. I'm enjoying my personal sanctuary. I've talked to Paula, hey, what are we going to eat? We talk about what we're going to eat. Maybe we're going to grill something. Maybe she's going to cook something. I'm just going to keep sitting there on my butt watching TV, whatever. Then we're going to eat. We're going to just have our personal sanctuary. And, you know, your home needs to be a personal sanctuary sometimes, right? My point is, it just doesn't have to be just a personal sanctuary. It could also be the tool that God has used you, that you could use this for hospitality with others. You can invite others to come into your home, and you could hang out with them. You can invite them over and be hospitable to them. But a lot of times we don't do that. I mean, how many people outside your immediate family even know what the inside of your home looks like? We just don't do this very much anymore. But it can be a powerful tool that God can use in the lives of others to invite them in. And God can use hospitality in great ways. I read an article about the lost art of Christian hospitality. It's out there. It's written by Scott Pauley. I don't know a lot about this guy. But a few of the things he said in the article really resonated with me. Hospitality can be used as a tool. Hospitality shows the heart of God to others. Showing hospitality is one of the greatest ways to demonstrate the love and kindness of God. It does more than just say, God bless you, right? I mean, we can say, hey, God bless you, and just keep moving. Or we can be used through hospitality as a channel for the blessing to others. God can use us and move us to do hospitable things for others, and it can start to be used by God. Christian hospitality opens the heart of others to God. As the love of God is shown, the hearts of others, the hearts of lost can be tenderized by that. God can use you, and God can use the acts of kindness and the hospitality to be the very thing to help soften the hard heart of that one that's so far away from God. He can use you when others experience a kindness that they didn't deserve. When others receive generosity that they don't understand why they're receiving this generosity, God can use those things to start softening the heart of a hardened heart, that people could see that maybe something they've never experienced before, and God can use that to start to get through to their heart with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Christian hospitality opens our heart to God and others as well. Isn't it amazing how God has designed life so that what is good for others is also good for us? Hospitality is good for others, but hospitality is good for you. God can do a deep work in your life while you're practicing hospitality. As we minister to others, the Lord ministers to us. Hospitality can become the Lord's classroom to teach us and to be His hospital to heal us. Through hospitality, I know of a precious woman in the life of our church who lost a loved one many years ago, and was brokenhearted over it. But the way that she's dealt with that loss is she's dedicated herself to the local church through service and hospitality to others. And if I said her name, you would know her. I don't want to single her out. She's a precious, dear woman of God. And she has said that God has ministered to her so much through her acts of service and hospitality that as she is a blessing to others, God is helping her grow and healing her and blessing her as well. And that's how that works. What a wonderful way to live. Hospitality is important. Loving others is important. But also we see a call for compassion here too towards others. We need to be compassionate people. You see what God's word says? It says also remember those who are in prison as though in prison with them and those who are mistreated. You think there are any mistreated people in our world today? What do you think? Is there any people in prison today? Yeah, sadly. So sadly. This verse is most likely in the immediate context a reference to fellow Christians who had been jailed and mistreated in their faith. But we know it's not just a call to those Christians who were jailed and mistreated at that time. This is also a general call for us to be compassionate people, to be people with a heart of love that will care about those who are in prison, and we will care for those who have been mistreated. We are called to be those people. We're called to be those people. I like what Ray Stedman said. He said, even those in prison justly merit Christian help, since Jesus ministered to the guilty and the condemned simply because they were human beings. Just because someone's locked up doesn't mean they don't need to be ministered to. And of all people, don't they need to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ and to be ministered to? Should we not have compassion enough to go and to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with them? This justice system is real, and justice oftentimes is meted out correctly in this life. But sometimes the innocent are found guilty, and the guilty go free in this life. And we're called to go and minister to those who are in hard places, and not just be thankful that we're not in those hard places, but that we go, and that we care, and we care about the mistreated. We don't just thank God that we're not mistreated, but we have a heart for others. We are motivated by love on our race of faith. Now, that doesn't mean if someone is in prison and they come to faith in Christ that they then just get out of prison. That's not what that means. I remember there was a story some years back of a lady who had tragically, she did something horrible and she was in prison for it. She prayed to receive Christ as her Savior, and then she believed that she should now get out because she's a Christian now, so she should just get out and not face any consequences. That's not how that works, I don't believe. People who are in prison, they can come to faith in Christ, and God bless them, but we know there's still consequences for our sin. But it doesn't mean they don't need to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. It doesn't mean that we don't need to be looking out to help those who are mistreated in this world. We're called to be people of love and to love others, even in hard places and in hard situations. Hospitality and compassion are powerful if we will live them in our lives. And I'm just saying, the writer of Hebrews must have thought it was pretty important as he's talking about this race of faith and persevering to the end. He's talking about how we have brotherly love continuing among us, and then we're going to those in prison and those who are mistreated. We need to demonstrate love on our race of faith. It's not always easy, but we're called to demonstrate it. Now we turn the corner and we see the third point that we consider today, and it's a very easy, kind of light point, and that's the point of marriage. Not easy, not light. But we must see what is being said here. Let marriage be held in honor among all. And let the marriage bed be undefiled, for God will judge the sexually immoral and the adulterous. Okay. These Jewish Christians were living in a culture much like ours. They lived in a sea of really sexual perversion and indulgence. But Christians were to live differently than the culture around them. They were to do something. They were to honor marriage. In the midst of a culture that was ate up with sinfulness. The call for us today is to do the same thing. We, believers in Christ, on our race of faith, we are to honor marriage. Good. I got an amen, so I can move on now. We honor marriage by looking at what God says about marriage and living that out. Christian sexual morality was unique in a pagan world for these Christians. They lived differently. And if we honor marriage and we live differently in the sexual morality of our lives, we too will be seen as different and even odd to the culture around us. But that's good and that's okay. Okay, is everybody with me? We honor marriage when we hold to certain things. Christian marriage is to be a committed, monogamous relationship. Christian marriage is to be committed, monogamous. You may say, well, why are you saying that? I mean, doesn't everybody understand that? No, everyone doesn't understand that. You say, you really, that people don't understand that that marriage should be monogamous? No, they don't. I know that because there are even new shows on television, and I have not watched a show. I don't encourage you to watch a show, but it's all about people who are in marriages that are more than just two people, right? I don't have to get much more graphic than that. But Christians have to understand that a Christian marriage, we honor a Christian marriage when we understand we're in a committed, monogamous relationship. Christian marriage also is honored when we understand that it's between one man and one woman. You can go all the way back to Genesis chapter 2, verse 24 to find out kind of the origins of that. And you may say, well, that's very simplistic in your understanding of marriage. That's okay because it's right. Marriage is between one man and one woman. And we honor marriage when we believe that. And we dishonor marriage when we say it's something other than that. That's just what Scripture says very plainly. Christian marriage is pictured for us through the relationship of Jesus Christ as the bridegroom and the church as his bride. We honor marriage when we understand that. We honor Christian marriage that it is sealed with a covenant made before God for a lifetime between two people. We honor marriage when we believe that. Now, it's hard because sometimes what happens with marriage is that Christians, even in our culture today, will say, well, you know, I believe that Christian marriage is between a man and a woman. Great, that's right. But also, if you believe that Christian marriage is between a man and a woman, you also need to live out the truths that we find in Ephesians 5 and fulfill our roles in that marriage. We can't just say, well, I believe in that marriage between a man and a woman, but we put no effort into our marriages. So we've got to take the roles of marriage very seriously, and we honor Christian marriage when we take Ephesians 5 seriously and we live out those roles in the marriage relationship. But we live in a world that sees adultery as no big deal, purity as abnormal or weird, and sex as a right to be practiced with whomever, however, whenever I want to experience it. That's the world we live in. We live in a time where really sex is just recreational. We've redefined marriage. We've done all these things. And in the midst of that, Christians have to honor marriage. We've got to rightly understand marriage and encourage marriage in our context. So what can we do in this world to honor marriage, for all of us to honor marriage, to let love continue? We need to see marriage as fulfilling and gratifying and not limiting. And I'm talking really to Christians here. We need to not just endure marriage, we need to be fulfilled in marriage, Christians. Right? Too many Christians just, you know, I've been married 55 years and I'm going to keep getting married. I'm not going anywhere. I'm enduring till the end. No. No, 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 no. Marriage is work and it's hard. I know. But marriage is fulfilling. It is good. It is for our good. We don't just endure marriage. We live in it in a fulfilling way. And you know what? If we want our children to one day get married and think marriage is an okay thing, maybe they should see in us that we are thankful for our marriage. And I know this is hard. Listen, I'm married too. I've been married 34 years, right? Yeah, 34 years. I knew it. 34 years. Listen, you got to put a lot of work in. But by God's grace, I pray that our children have seen that marriage is worth it. And it is good. And it's not just to be endured, but we can find fulfillment in it even when it's hard. It's hard being married. It is tough, but we can see it's good. It's good. Another way we can honor marriage is simply this. We commit ourselves to monogamy. We're committed. I'm going to be with that person for the rest of my life, that one person. And I think there's some practical things that we can do to encourage staying with that person for the rest of our life and to be in a marriage that's fulfilling. I'm going to give you some practical things, and I know a lot of you have a really good memory, so you don't need to write it down. But you may want to write it down. If you're listening at home, you may want to write these down. If you want to commit to be with your spouse for a lifetime and only your spouse, why don't you pray for your spouse? Amen. Why don't you and your spouse pray together? It will help your marriage relationship. Pray for your spouse and pray together. Number two, keep dating your spouse. Now you say, oh, well, you're getting all practical here. I feel like I'm at a marriage conference. Listen, I'm telling you, you've got to continually invest in your marriage and not just be married and then, okay, hey, we're married now. I can just, you know, be lazy. No, we got to continue to put the effort in. Continue to date your spouse. Here's one that's very practical, and I'm just going to share it. You need to share your passwords with your spouse. You share your passwords with your spouse. I have nothing to hide. It will encourage monogamy. It will encourage you to be with that woman or that man for the rest of your life. You say, well, where are you getting this stuff at? Well, from years and years of counseling. Practical things that people could do to help protect their marriage. Why don't you talk regularly with your spouse? Communicate. Not just, well, I married her 30 years ago, told her I loved her, she ought to know it. We talk regularly with our spouse. We share ourselves with our spouse. Don't keep any hidden relationships from your spouse. Don't have any hidden relationships. At work or on social media. I said it. You say, why are you saying that? Because it's a problem. It's a big, big problem. I'm going to give you one that's going to blow your mind, guys. Communicate openly and clearly about your needs and the need for fulfillment. If I'm going to be married to that one woman for my whole life, I want her to know what makes me tick, and I want her to know what my needs are, and I want her to know how it is that I feel fulfilled in this relationship. I want to be married. I want to be happily married. I want to be fulfilled in my marriage. I want to be, do you know what I'm talking about? Your wife needs to be heard. Your heart needs to ache to know what makes her tick. Put the work in. This all will encourage you to be married to that woman, to that man, for the rest of your life. And for all that to happen, we need to prioritize these roles that we find in Ephesians 5. We can't unpack that today. Look it up. Live that way with your spouse. That's how we honor marriage. You say, Pastor, I don't know, man. It feels like we've been all over the place today, man. We're talking about, you know, brotherly love and ethnicity and one race, and then we're talking about hospitality and compassion. Yeah, we're talking about, why are we talking about all that? Because it's in the text. Then you end up with marriage. Because it was important for these Jewish Christians to be marked by love for one another to be marked by love for those outside the church and to be marked by love in their marriages if they were going to run their race of faith. And we've got to be marked by the same things. We've got to be marked by the same things. It's hard to continue on if we're not marked by love. So this is one of those messages that God puts together sometimes, and maybe one point or another point, or maybe no point, I don't know. Wherever it lands for you, will you consider what God is saying to you today? Where is it that love needs to blossom or bloom at in your life? Maybe there's some areas that we talk about today, you're knocking it out of the park. Great, that's awesome. Maybe there's another area where you're really struggling. Don't beat yourself up for struggling. Run to Christ and ask Him to help you with what you need to be able to live out love in these ways. We all need it. Love is needed. In the church, outside the church, and in our marriages, we all need love. And we need it to finish our race of faith. May God make it be so in all of our lives. Let's pray. Dear God, we love You. We thank You for this day. We would ask for You to do a deep work in our lives and to help us, to encourage us to live in love. Dear God, help us not to redefine it. Help us not to cast it in another light other than what we find in Scripture. Just help us to hear the Word of God and live it in our lives. Dear God, help me personally, as there's many times where I've struggled in my life. Dear God, encourage me to run back to Your truth. Dear God, help me to be sensitive to the ways in which I've not been loving and the ways that I need to be loving. Dear God, help us all. I pray that each person here would look into their lives and to ask You, through the power of the Holy Spirit, to reveal to them what it is that they need to learn and take away from this message today. We love You. We pray it in Christ's name. Amen. As we come to the conclusion of this message, I would ask you to consider the truth. If you're a believer here in the room or at home, would you consider the need for enduring love in your life? But if you're here in this room or at home, wherever you may be, if you're not a believer in Jesus Christ and you've just been watching, you're hearing about this, it's impossible to live out this kind of love if you first do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. But if you will come to Him and see your great need that we all have, which is common to us all, the sin problem that we have, if you will come and by faith ask for forgiveness of your sin, turn from your sin and turn to Christ, He'll forgive you of that sin, He'll make you a new creation in Christ, and you too will be now in the family of God. And He will, through the power of the Holy Spirit, help you to live out love in the ways that we've considered today. But for that to happen, you've got to first come to Him. And if that's what you need to do, I would encourage you, if you're in the room, to take your bulletin and on the response card, write your name and your interest in knowing more about Christ. If you're at home and you desire to know more about Christ, or you want to talk about something in the message, you can email me at ascott@oakhillbc.org. If you're here today and you fill out one of those response cards on your way out, would you put it in the offering plate as you leave, and we'll collect it, and I promise you I'll call you and I'll follow up with you. Maybe you have a prayer concern, write that down as well. Whatever it may be, you respond as God would call you to respond. We're going to sing the song together, and as you're singing, ask God to speak to you. Would you join me standing here in the room, and let's ask God to use His word to speak to our lives.